to show exactly what I think a few, and we've seen a few questions around this, around the tiers and the models and what you can attach and where you can start. And what I've tried to do here is just three slides on saying, let's just start really simple. So let's just start with what you can get today. So if you needed to produce some numbers today and you had literally no other information, what you would be able to do is go to the global data sets, attach those to the Flint, get your reporting rules, which are just the standard global reporting rules, attach the IPCC Tier 1 modules and the Tier 1 database, and click go. Now that's going to give you a set of results. It's going to put it out into the UNFCCC reports. There is, of course, going to be high uncertainty around those numbers because you are just taking global data sets and using them, but you actually have something. And you can actually do that quite quickly. And fortunately, again, thanks to the UNFCCC Secretariat, a number of these data sets we have found, we have pre-processed, and are available through Moja Global. So you can actually start very simple, very quickly. And we are looking to keep those up to date as the new data comes in. So that's been a really core part of some of the support that the UNFCCC has provided us, is to make sure those data sets are there so that you don't have to go hunting all over the internet and all over the world to try to find them and try to collate them. So now you have a system. Now it's not a very good system, but every country started with a system that looked like this. And then they started to build. So the next year, you could end up with this data. You could have some nationally specific cover and land use data, for example, maybe developed from SEEPL, maybe purchased from a commercial provider, maybe built yourself. These are all options. You still may use some global and national stratification data as well, though. You may have changed some reporting rules, some policy and national reporting rules that you may be using. And for your key categories, you may have lifted a few models up to Tier 2, maybe Tier 3. So if it's a really important sector, you've moved a couple of the key ones to Tier 2, but you've left all the rest at Tier 1. To do that, you've had to add some of your own country-specific databases, so a bit of extra data into the data, into a database to say, no, don't use an IPCC Tier 1 emissions factor, please use our own Tier 2 factor. And that's where you suddenly have now we've got a system that's actually running. It's still not perfect by any stretch, but it's vastly improved. And it's been quite quick to improve because you're focusing on where the big problems are. You're not trying to chase lots of little things. You're using the system to identify here are actually where the biggest uncertainties are. We are going to focus our measurement campaign, or we are going to focus our new mapping program, or we're going to focus what resources we have on chasing the things that give us the highest uncertainty and to reduce those. And then you can add more. And so this is for a much more advanced system. You've got more and more data coming in. You've probably moved more and more modules from Tier 1 to Tier 2 or to Tier 3. You may have even jumped some Tier 2s to Tier 3s through that process. You may add some non-carbon models, as we've talked before. Maybe there's some need for those for co-benefit reporting. You've got more advanced databases. And now down the bottom that you can see here is you can do lots of different reporting. Yes, you can send things to the UNFCCC, but maybe you're also doing national reporting for other purposes and other scenarios. And so all through these three diagrams, hopefully what you've seen is that the middle bit, the Flint, hasn't changed. It's still sitting there. What's changing is the models you attach and the data you feed it. But the core framework remains the same. When we talk about the Flint, we'll often talk about different simulation types. We can run spatially referenced and spatially explicit estimates. I'm not going to go into too much of this at the moment because we're going to go through this data as we talk about it later, and you will see these examples. But the key thing is the middle point. You can trigger activities and disturbances through multiple mechanisms. You're not stuck to remote sensing. You can use statistical rules, for example, and you can use management regimes inside a database to actually set what's going on across the landscape. That means that you have a very high degree of flexibility, especially where remote sensing doesn't see things. So, and these also mix. So, for example, you may have, what you may find is that you have a remote sensing product, and that remote sensing product says there has been a disturbance in this forest. There's been a harvest. That's great, but that doesn't tell you how much that forest was harvested. Did they remove 20% of the trees? Did they take 30 or 40% of the trees? So what the system can do is it combines that information with data on the management regimes. So in Canada, for example, you may have an area that says, look, if there's a harvest in this state, they typically harvest the forest at this intensity. And you can apply that rule. That then gets used to determine where the carbon goes and the emissions. So you have this huge flexibility in what you're actually feeding the system. This is the core framework of the system, and I'm going to go through this slide and add text to it as we go, because it looks a bit confusing at first, and of course it's very good, as you've seen so far, to have lots of pretty pictures with arrows moving between them. But that doesn't help you when you're actually trying to think about really what's happening. But what we have on the left-hand side is our spatial data. To the right-hand side of the dotted line, we have our database. We also have our integration framework, and we have our output system. This is what an integration of a tier 1, 2/3 all in one place would look like as a generalized design. The first part is our time series of information. So this is bringing in a raster format in this example out of remote sensing. A key part of this work is that the time series has to be consistent, and that is fundamental to the underpinning processing of this system. So really important that when you design your remote sensing program for doing your forest cover change, that you actually have time methods that ensure time series consistency in the results. If you don't have those, if you're just producing a map and then another map and then another map, then you're going to hit problems with the flint. But you're also going to hit problems with any system you use. It's just that the system, the flint, sees it really clearly because it's looking at this land unit point. What this is doing, and you can see the little red circle on here, it's looking at that one land unit. So the little red circle is green, so it's a forest, and then it's gone to yellow, which we're saying is agriculture, for a few years, and then it's gone back to green. And so what you can see is this is basically, it's been deforested, it's been used as another land use for a few years, and then it's gone to back to forest. The most common data set still used in this is a forest non-forest data set to start with, often derived from Landsat, so sort of in the nominal 25 to 30 meter resolution, typically, you know, 0.00025 decimal degrees is really where you want to be, helps you line up data. But noting, of course, that Sentinel is coming, much higher resolution, and there's even more higher resolution information coming. And as such, you know, the system is flexible, it can cope with that. The key point, though, is that the denser your time series, it captures better the land use dynamics and therefore the emissions and removals. And we'll give some examples of that later as well. So that gives us, for this land unit, the information on what's happened on that land unit. There's also a whole series of ancillary spatial data that sits in underneath that. So for that individual land unit, because of the models we've attached, we probably need to know what the forest type is. The forest type may be used to determine the biomass. It may be used to determine the management that's being applied to that forest. It may be used to actually stratify out so you can report by different forest types, for example. You may also need information on soil type. If you're running a soils model, you'll need to know what the type is. And by soil type, that could get even more sophisticated. That may be clay content, water holding capacity, texture, all of these things. It's going to depend on the model that you're applying. Those spatial layers come in, and administrative boundaries, for example. So often management changes by administrative boundaries, but also you may wish to report. So if you're reporting at a state or provincial level, then you'll need the system to know, is that land unit in this administrative boundary, so you can report by that. And so there's a whole additional set of spatial data. So going back to the question that was raised earlier, this certainly does not displace the need for GIS experts. you will need that mix of skills in amongst all the other skills you need to run a system, because you need to be able to manage this spatial data and get that spatial data into the system. There's then the databases. They look small in this diagram. They're actually probably one of the most important parts. And what the databases do is they look at the spatial information and determine which emissions factors to apply, or which growth models, or which parameters to apply in those points, depending on the tier that you're running at. They might set the reach-shoot ratios. They also contain the management information. So as I went back to before, if you have a forest that's been harvested, what's the impact of that harvest? How much carbon was removed? How much was taken out as wood products? What's the subsequent management that remote sensing may not be able to see? So for example, if you are in a forest that is clear felled, and then does it need to be burnt, or do you just replant into the clear fell? You know, those are the things that need to go in. The data is all sourced from the regular places. So you'll find that it's really just sitting there and building it. IPCC guidelines tier one, that's pretty well there. That would be consistent with what's in the IPCC reporting tool. The National Forest Inventories, if you have that type of information and you're converting it into emissions factors, that might be tier two. Or if you're building tier three models using National Forest Inventories combined with scientific literature and scientific models and research sites, and probably the best example of that combination would again be Canada. That is obviously a really good way of doing it. So that's up to you at a country level. The data integration and modeling framework, look, this is where the integration, or you know, where the magic happens, if you want to get all excited about it. The Flint basically builds a simulation for every single unit. So every unit that comes in, it is going to build a time series model. And this is what I was trying to get to when I started earlier, saying that it runs time then space. So what it's doing is it's getting a land unit and it is looking through all of the information through time for that land unit. And it's dragging all of that together. It's then running that land unit. And that's its job. There's a couple of really important aspects to this, though, is that it's running the models that subscribe, but it's not just running the not running each model just individually. So it's not running, here's a forest model, and here's the crop model, and here's this. It's actually stopping at every time step. It's really important that to understand that concept, because what that means is that it means the models can talk to each other. So if you have a forest model that is then putting material, say harvest slash, or just from turnover, putting material into the dead organic matter pools, then it means that the model stops at the end of the time step, it updates all the carbon pools, then the dead organic matter pools can act on those pools. So it's meaning that you can have all of these models actually talking to each other in a consistent way. Really helps with ensuring mass balance, helps ensure you're not getting double counting of lands and or carbon pools. The key thing to remember here is that this produces a lot of data, as you can imagine. So I would challenge you to sit there with Excel maybe and put some of these numbers into it and see how big the number gets. But if you can imagine that you're running, say, a 25 meter pixel across your entire country. So take the number of hectares in your country and multiply it by 16. You're then doing it maybe for 100 years if you're running projections as well as reporting. Maybe you're running monthly time steps if you're running more sophisticated models. You may have 30 pools, but all of those pools are talking to each other, and you then may wish to report by other categories. And when you actually multiply those numbers together, what you'll find is that it is extraordinarily large. Most of that data is not going to be useful. It's needed for the simulations, but it's not needed for your reporting. So a huge job there is actually then dropping it into the outputs, which is what I'm going to talk about next. The key part for there is that the outputs can be categorized later. So these maps that we're putting into the system and this data, they are not maps that are saying I am an IPCC grassland or I am IPCC cropland. They're saying I am currently a crop, and now I am currently a grass, and now I am currently a forest. it's not the system's job to apply those policy rules. You apply those at the end. And there's a very good reason for that, which is that when you actually look at the way that the IPCC land categorization is done, is that you actually need to understand the history of the land units to put them into the correct category. Just because something is a crop doesn't mean that it's currently in the crop land use category. Just because something's been seen as a grassland doesn't necessarily mean that it is in the grassland category. That's a really important point to remember, that the IPCC categorizations aren't just what's there, but it's what's happening before as well helps determine that, and after, actually, just to make it more complicated. We then have the outputs, and these are the results from the FLINT. So those come out in multiple different ways. You can drop them out as maps. Now, that answers one of the questions I saw earlier, which is really important. Yes, you can take the maps and put them back into your MGIS system. So if you're trying to answer other questions like, we're going to build some roads, what's the potential biomass loss? You could actually take some of these outputs and put them into a different GIS system and use them as part of those other analyses. That's not a limitation at all. It's a key feature of what we're trying to do. It produces large databases. Again, you can take those databases and put them into other databases. You can do all of these sorts of things. The data is there. You can also produce point models, which I won't go into here. The outputs are generally aggregated in some way. If you look at the maths from the last slide, you'll understand that you can't actually store all of the data that a simulation runs. There is a fair degree of expertise in getting that aggregation piece up, but that again is largely being solved by the Mojo Global community, so you don't need to worry about it. So the key thing here is that the problem of huge volumes of data is being solved through the Mojo Global community so that you don't need to worry about it. And finally, that we're overlaying the policy requirements on the outputs. So that means that what we do, and you saw that in the other slides, we do one run and we can do lots of different reports from that one run, meaning that we know that everything is nice and consistent. So as a summary of the data input requirements, we have databases that have model parameters. There's examples and templates and things that have run on Mojo. They're all available. You can have a look at those. If you start adding more advanced models, you are going to have to reconfigure your database. And again, this comes to, sorry, what skills do you need in your team? Do you need to have a database person for a few months to reconfigure a database to make it work for your country? Maybe you do, but maybe the templates and the things on Mojo will work fine. That's a country choice. You have a time series of your cover land use maps. They can come in different formats. And again, how you get those maps is going to depend on your needs, whether you want to run SQL again or whether you're looking at other providers for that information. But there are some really important key characteristics of those maps, and the main one being they have to be time series consistent. If they're not time series consistent, you are going to find problems. There's other time series maps, and there's maps only for stratification, and that's pretty much it. And I'll finish on this thing, because the best way to think about the FLINT is not to think about AD times EF and think of a spreadsheet. If you think like in that way, then it gets very complicated. I would encourage you to stop and actually think as if you're a piece of land, and you're a piece of land over time. If you start thinking in that way and say, I am this piece of land, then you can start asking these simple questions. What has happened to me over time? Was I a forest and then I was deforested in 1987 when I was turned over to a crop, and then in 1996 I was turned back to a eucalypt plantation for trees, and then I was harvested and then I was planted back into a second rotation as a forest? Or, you know, was I burnt? What products came from me? When you actually think of yourself as a piece of land through time, that really explains exactly what the FLINT's trying to do. You're a piece of land. Here's the things that have happened to me. When those things happened to me, how did that impact my carbon stocks? How did that impact my emissions? How did that impact my subsequent removals? And that also means you can start thinking like a piece of land of, well, what happens to me in the future? What happens if I am cleared again? What happens if this happens? So if you get away from the spreadsheet thinking of getting a big number of area, you know, 27,000 hectares multiplied by a number, and you think about, no, I'm this little piece, and then understand that all of your country is just lots of little pieces of land, then you come up to the concept of the flint and how it runs. Similar data streams, different way of thinking about it.